Morning, and how is everybody doing? Welcome to another live video on our page here, talking about our word of the week, one of my absolute favorite life skill education points and emotional intelligence education points to cover. It is compassion week for us as I'm doing this video. Hello, Miss Rose, for joining us on our compassion week video, where I mostly just want to talk about compassion. I think everybody knows what compassion is, and we teach it to our kids. I think most people teach the idea of compassion to their kids in the same way that we do, that it really just means caring a whole awful lot. That's the easy way for kids to understand, but where I think there's a lot of disconnect is in how people learn to apply compassion. Because it seems that a lot of people like to talk about it. It's like they love the idea of compassion, or they're in love with the idea of being compassionate, but they don't necessarily apply or live the idea of compassion, and instead make excuses to themselves. Well, that person's probably just trying to cheat me, or that person's probably not legit, or that homeless guy should work harder, or that person's not trying hard enough to get a job, whatever it is, right? We make these excuses to not be compassionate. So always ask yourself, do you love the idea of compassion, or do you live the idea of compassion? And that's a completely different thing. So I'm gonna break this down for something that would be difficult for kids to understand, but hopefully it's a little easier for adults to understand. Maybe you guys can break it down in a different way and how you show how to apply compassion to your children. One of the first things I deal with in talking about people and compassion is that you have to learn to recognize when your own ego steps involved. And that's very difficult to do. Basically, if your thoughts are using the terms like I and me and my, so my point of view, my experience, the way I see it, that means that you're speaking from your point of view. That's your ego that you're thinking from. Now, there's nothing wrong with the ego. It's part of what sets us apart as individuals, is part of what makes us unique. But I think it's important to understand and learn when to recognize when you're speaking from that ego, because so many times people will try to be compassionate and their intention is to show compassion. Their heart is in the right place, but it may not be right because they're thinking about it in terms of how they relate to the situation. So, case in point, say you're trying to show compassion to somebody who's hurting or sad by communicating with them in a way to let them feel like they're not alone. It's really easy for you to start talking from your point of view and start thinking of, what can I do to help this person? What can I say to make this person feel better? What's an experience I've had that I can tell this person to help relate to that? But the thing is if you really step back, you recognize that that's coming from ego. So the heart is wanting to show compassion, but if you're bringing it about and applying it through ego, then you're kind of missing the point of compassion and showing your ability to care. So this comes down to something you've heard as a kid. Put yourself in another person's shoes. Have you ever walked a mile in their shoes? Gotta learn to take that to heart. That stuff is real. So instead of, if you catch yourself asking yourself something like, I wanna show compassion to this person, so how can I show compassion to this person? Change that question to, what does this person need? What would help this person? Take the I and me out of the question, and you begin to take the ego and personal thought out of the question, which means that you're not gonna leave yourself the room to give yourself excuses as to why to end up not showing that person compassion, right? Because then you think about, you're driving down the road, you see somebody with a flat tire, they're changing the tire, so maybe obviously they know how to do it, maybe they don't. You can just because it looks like they know what they're doing doesn't mean that they do, right? Maybe you know how to change a tire, maybe you don't. But then you start thinking, right? And your question first is, I want to help that person, so what can I do to help? Well, I don't know how to change a tire, so I guess there's nothing I can do, right? And then you make an excuse not to help that person. And then you accept that excuse to justify, to feel better, and you move on. But that's not being compassionate, that's being in love with the idea of being compassionate. If you actually want to be compassionate, you would switch that question in your brain. And instead of asking yourself what you can do to help that person, you would see that person and ask yourself, what does that person need right now? Well, they need help changing a tire. They probably feel nervous because they're on the side of the road. If I was there sitting on the side of the road, I'd probably feel nervous about someone hitting me. So someone being able to wave traffic and they might be thirsty, hot, etc., right? So then that takes away the ability to even make the excuse that I can't do anything to help, because suddenly now I realize that I can turn around at this gas station up here, run in, grab a bottle of cold water, run it down there to them, hand them the cold water, and stand there and direct traffic away from them while they finish, you know, changing their tire. So there you go. Do you love the idea of compassion, or do you live the idea of compassion? There's a difference. There's a big difference between the two, and it all comes from your ego. Not trying to say ego is a bad thing, but you do need to learn to recognize when you're coming from your ego and how to turn it off if you need to. So putting yourself in another person's shoes and thinking, what do they need in the situation, instead of what can I give them in the situation, will help you a lot in being able to apply compassion. So how do I go about this with children, like with my own child? One, I try to be the example as much as I can. But two, if I see him trying to help me, trying to show me compassion, or trying to show mommy compassion, and it's not working out, right? Like the intention's there, but it's in the way or something like that. We all have kids that do that, maybe try to be a little bit too helpful. One of the ways that I'll approach that is I'll look at Axel and I'll say, okay, did you ask yourself what you could do to help me? Or did you ask yourself what I need to be helped with? And that usually makes him stop. And I'll say, now, okay, you figured that you asked yourself what you could do to help me. So you thought that distracting me from what I'm doing with that joke would make me happier, but you didn't actually ask yourself what I need or want in that moment. You asked yourself what you could do. So then I'll put the question on him and I'll say, all right, I know you want to show me compassion. So how about this? You see what I'm doing. You see I'm working. You see I'm getting stressed. So instead of you asking yourself what you can do to help me out, how about you ask yourself what I need? What do you think I need that's going to help me out? And he'd say something like, well, you know, you need to have more confidence in what you're doing. You need to not take what you're doing so seriously. And I look at him, I say, exactly. So you think telling me a joke is going to help with that? And he'd say, yes. I say, okay, but now you got to go from my point of view. I'm stuck in this. You know I'm stuck. So instead of asking yourself, how can you help me get unstuck? Ask yourself, what's actually going to get me to get unstuck? You know you're my child. You know I'd do anything for you. So maybe ask me to get something for you first, because you already know as my child that I will mindlessly say, yes, of course, I'll get up and get you a drink of water if you ask me to. And he'll look at me and go, yeah, yeah. Every time I ask you to do that, you go get a drink of water. Okay. So then I'll say, let's back up, try it again. And I'll go back to being my stressed on the computer and I'll role play it with them. And then I'll have him come over and go, hey, daddy, you look like, or hey, daddy, I'm kind of thirsty. I'm having trouble with the ice maker. Can you help me get a drink? And I'll go, oh, yeah, of course, son. And then I get up there and start the drink. And then he tells me his joke again. And then I laugh and I say, see, now I'm more invested in what you wanted to do. I'm more invested in what you were saying. I'm more invested in your joke. So now you are actually helping me through your compassion rather than trying to relate to me. Now, it's also important to let people know, especially when they're dealing with depression and sadness, that you do understand, but you don't have to do it in a way of relating to them. You can do it in a way of describing the feeling. So instead of saying, when someone opens up to you and says, hey man, this is going on, my wife left me, or we're fighting, you know, I don't know, whatever their situation is, and they're upset, instead of being like, yeah, I had this fight with my wife too once, and blah, 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 so I know how you feel. No, that's not really helpful, because now you kind of like just saying that you've had the feelings too. It's kind of invalidating to them, right? But if you really want to show compassion, you won't ask yourself what I know that relates to them. You'll ask yourself what they need to feel like is related to them. So then they tell you the same sob story. Let's go with the same example. Oh, I just had a fight with my wife. She left, she took the kids. I lost my temper, I lost control. I don't know what to do about it, blah, blah, blah. Now, instead of saying, well, I can relate to that because I've been through this before, you can ask yourself, well, what does this person really need? Well, they need to know that someone understands how they feel, so that if they feel like someone understands how they feel, then they're going to be more open to take advice from that person. So therefore, this is basic psychology 101, guys. Psychology 101. Learn that. Learn your communication skills. Anyway, that's part of our leadership program in the martial arts, by the way. So let me try to get back on topic. Where was I? I got to rambling. You guys know how I do. So that person gives that soft story. Instead of giving them a story that of your own that relates to it, you can say, man, that must really hurt right here. Like, I understand that it must feel like and it must feel like you got nothing left. You must have like, I get it. It's got to be this hole that just makes you so sick inside. And you'll get them going, yeah, man, that's exactly what it feels like. Yeah, man. And then your head starts pounding and, you know, the thoughts start racing. And it's almost like you can't think about anything else. You get hyper-focused in. You just stuck. You get stuck in that mind. And I know it's a dark place, right? And you kind of feel like no one cares. You're all lonely. Man, I know it's tough, isn't it? And then they're like, yeah, man, yeah, it really is. Well, guess what? Now that person knows I can relate to them and doesn't feel like I'm playing tit for tat with them and comparing my experience to theirs. Do you understand how changing how you communicate with somebody, changing that question you ask yourself when you're trying to show compassion to people, can change your level of compassion that you're actually able to show to people? And that's what I'm saying. So now that person knows that I can relate to them, but I've not played tit for tat in their mind in any way, shape, or form. I've not told them how I know how they feel. I've just told them by describing the feelings that I recognize how they feel. Now from there, they're gonna start talking a little more and they're gonna be more willing to listen to me. So from that point on, I just make sure that maybe I draw from an experience I had, but I don't talk about the experience I had. So they say, you know, they start, blah, 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 I don't know what to do from here. And I say, and then you might say, just start asking questions that you asked yourself, like, well, what do you think they need right now? What do you think would mean the most to them? I mean, they're your family, that's your wife, you know her better than anybody else. What do you think she needs the most right now? Well, she needs to know she's safe around me. She needs to know this. She needs to know that, she needs to know that I'm not gonna lose control. She needs to know that this, she needs to know, okay, cool. Now, how then are you going to show her that? And then that's where you start the process of bringing the ego back in so that you can begin to take action. So what do you guys think, right? This is my concept of compassion. And honestly, compassion is one of my favorites. It's something that I've delved into quite deeply into my own soul because I've realized that through compassion, I can control my ego, which means I can control my humility, which gives me much higher level of control of my emotion, even against my physical disorders. It gives me a coping mechanism to help me deal with it, and it helps me be able to relate to people and help people better and show more compassion in a better way, right? So this is how I talk about showing compassion in a better way. So you guys, Mr. Haysmer, Ms. Brittany, that have been on this video so far, what do you guys think, right? What do you guys think of the way I talk about compassion, the way I'm bringing it up? I'll give a quick run through again from Ms. Brandy. Please, 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 though, go back and watch the video if you haven't already seen it. I think we're like 10 minutes in now, but which I've kind of said my piece. I don't want to double up on anybody too much, but I'll quick recap, right? You've got to change the way you look in your mind. Too many people are in love with the idea of being compassionate, are in love with the idea of people thinking they're compassionate, but they don't live the idea of compassion because they got too much ego. They think too much like, what can I do for this person? How can I relate to this person? Where do I fit in the situation? What do I, me, my, that's ego. When you can recognize that and flip that question in your mind and go, no, it's not what I can do. What can I do for that person? It's what does that person need? Now you're starting to think from their point of view. That forces you to go, well, man, if my wife just left me and I just lost control and I had just blah, 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 and I had just lost my house, I'd be crushed and I'd feel like this. Now, instead of telling them the situation that maybe you experienced that gave you relative feelings that might make them feel like you just comparing with them, you can just describe the feeling that you imagine that they're probably having. Man, I know you're probably feeling so lonely right now and like sick to your stomach with that big hole. You're not sure it's hunger and you don't want to eat. Feel like you're going to throw up. I get it. You know, it's like your heart's probably pounding out of your chest right now and you feel so stuck, like you want to do something, but you just don't know what you can do. Your brain's reeling and all you can think about is all the bad things that the person you love thinks about you, whatever their situation is, right? Now I start talking like that and they know that I can relate to exactly how they feel and they don't feel like I've been tit for tat with them. They don't feel like I've been comparing myself to them in any way, shape, or form. Then they're going to be far more open to suggestion and advice, and never just give advice. Never give advice to anybody. Everybody has the answers to how to live their own life inside. The trick is quit thinking you know more about their life than they do. If you really want to help them out, it's not your advice they need. It's your ability to help them adjust their perspective that they need. And how you give them that is asking questions. Well, what do you think your wife needs right now? Well, what do you think your kid needs right now? What do you think would make your child feel better right now? What do you think you need right now? What do you think would make you feel better right now? And as they go, I don't know, then you can go into things. You know what makes me feel better sometimes? I really like to go for walks at 2 a.m. and scream heavy metal music in my head. By the way, if y'all ever see me walking down the road with the hoodie pulled low and the stuff, and I know I look like some guy's probably gonna rob your house, but you'll know I'm not because I got a little dog with me, right? Nobody runs around robbing houses with a little old dog that's 13 years old, and I'll be singing like death metal and stuff, right? But that's what I do. That's what I do to recharge. Maybe it's rap that day. I don't know, right? But that's what I do to recharge. So then maybe you make it say, oh man, this is what I do to help myself feel better. Do you have anything that you do? Like hot bath and stuff, man, I love a bubble bath. And you usually get them thinking, and then they'll start thinking, well, what is something I enjoy to do? And eventually they'll think of something. You know, I've always liked to blah, or I've always liked to play catch, or you know, I've always liked to play frisbee. I've always liked to go for walks. I've always liked to plant flowers. I've always liked to, whatever it is, play video games. I've always liked to watch movies. All right, hey man, I know a movie you need to see. Oh, hey man, I could use help in my garden. Oh, hey man, I could, and then just spend time with them. Then through spending time with them, they're gonna feel like someone actually cares about them as a friend, as a person, beyond themselves. So my question to you is, how good are you at seeing your own ego and seeing past your own line of vision and past how you fit into a situation? As Ms. Rose says there, healing can only happen through understanding, not through demanding. You can't demand another person understand what you say. Right, I heard this once when it came to leadership communication things I was at. Some network meeting, something. But it is really, really important, I think, when it comes to communicating with other people. It is the job of the communicator to communicate in a way that the communicatee can understand. It is not the job of the communicatee to force themselves to the level of understanding of the communicator. Meaning that, to a certain degree, you can't blame somebody else for not understanding what you're saying. You've got to understand that their life perspective and brain are completely different, and so are their thoughts. So you have to speak in a way that communicates to them, which means you have to understand them to a certain level. You have to know them to a certain level, and you can't do that if you're just in love with the idea of being compassionate. You've got to live the idea of being compassionate. And instead of asking yourself, what do I want this person to know about me? What do I want to share about this person as I make friends? Start asking yourself better questions like, what would this person like me to know about them? What can I learn? What is this person telling me about them that I can use later to show that I care about them and that I listen to them? That's what my brain does. Someone's communicating with me, my brain is constantly translating that as I'm being told someone's life story or sob story or whatever it is, my brain is translating that to not what do I need to do to help them, but what does this person need to feel better? And then trying to ask questions that'll be there, and then just simply lead them down a path of doing something that's gonna make them feel better, and then walk that path with them. And I keep those things in my mind anytime someone tells me something about themselves, so that sometime down the road later, I can come back and go, hey, you know, and give them a meaningful gift, or make them something, or say something more meaningful. And it's meaningful to them because they'll recognize and remember that I remembered that conversation, that thing they told me about me that they didn't think I cared about 4 weeks ago, a year ago. And they recognize that it's still there. I've got that stuff pinned in the back of my mind all the time. I know I appear to be extraordinarily forgetful, and to be honest, I am, but that's mostly just my short-term memory. And it's because, honestly, I spend the majority of my mental memory processes trying to remember as much as I can about people I care about. So I get a little spacey about other things sometimes and lose track of what I'm saying. So, oh, Brandy jumped in here. My thing is getting on a swing in an argument. walk to a playground and get on a swing. Oh, that's your thing to make you feel better. Yeah, man. Now, I never grew up close enough to a swing in a park to have that kind of thing, but I can understand that. I like swings today. Yeah, and you know, when you're a kid, it's important to let your parents know that you're going, you know, to do something. But when you're talking from a parent's point of view, you have to understand that talking to your kids is the same way. Their emotions are legit. You want them to be compassionate, you got to show them compassion. So don't ask what I can do for them. Don't ask what I should tell them to do. Ask what that child needs right now. Ask yourself that instead and put yourself in that child's shoes and how they feel. Understand that their feelings are very validated. Ask them, would it make you feel better to spend some time alone? Because within parameters, as long as I know where you're at, I can trust you to go as far as the tree line down here and why don't you take a stick and go beating on some trees, let out some aggression or something if you think you'd enjoy that. Here, borrow my iPod and my earphones too, man, if you want to go. Or if you want me to go with you, I'll go play with you and sword fight, right? And that's the way I do it with my son and the way I show compassion when he gets angry. And then when he's calmed down, then I'll talk to him about, hey, you know, man, that thing that made you angry, let's talk about that. Let's talk about how we could have handled that situation better now that we're good and calm. But this is how you show compassion to people who are sad, down, or otherwise. Not even people who are sad now. I gave an example early in this video about how many times we make excuses of not helping somebody on the side of the road because we don't think we can help them, because we ask ourselves, how can I help this person instead of what does this person maybe need? Which will tell you, hey, I got a bottle of water right here I could take out to them and spray it on their head to cool them down, and I could help keep traffic away from them so they don't have to panic, and I could do this, and I could put my car in the way so people, and I could blah, 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 blah. There's lots of things you could do to help, but you make the excuse that you can't help because you ask yourself, what can I do to help? And you either go, well, I don't know how to change the tire, or I know how to change the tire, but it appears that they do as well because they're already working on it, so they got it, so I'm busy, so I'm gonna go do my thing. And then we feel better about ourselves. We justify not showing compassion. We do. And there's always that fear too, that if we show compassion to somebody like a stranger, that they're somehow going to take advantage or scam us. And yes, there's a certain point that you need to have a certain level of wisdom and go, well, it's not like I was just being compassionate. You can take it or leave it past a certain point, but I'm not going to let you take me past the level I'm willing to go, right? Someone starts asking me for a ride, something feels fishy. That happened when I lived in Okmulgee, Oklahoma. Someone starts asking for a ride, something feels fishy, just straight up use my courtesy, bow out. Nah, man, nah, I'm not good with giving you a ride. And I'll just tell them straight, I'm just not good with giving you a ride. Why not? I don't know you. Well, you can trust me. Well, that's the thing. I can't trust anybody that says I can trust them, man. I have a process. You got to understand, it's like 6 months before I can start to build trust with you. I'm sorry, I can't give you a ride. I just can't do it. But I tell you what, I can call you an Uber. That's what I used to do. I'll call you an Uber. I'll call you a taxi. They say, well, I can't afford a taxi. I say, well, here's $5. You can afford a taxi, but I ain't giving you a ride. And then if it is a scam, and here's how you can tell it's a scam, they won't accept your call for a taxi. They will straight up storm off. And you got to know how to protect yourself, but you can still be yourself. And this is something I was trying to tell to somebody last night. I was having a deep conversation with somebody last night, and I was trying to tell them that you can be yourself. You can be the you that you're afraid to be because you're afraid people make fun of you, tease you, and this, that, and the other. As long as you learn to communicate to people in the way they need to be communicated to, in a way that speaks to them. This is how you do it. You do it through compassion. Compassion isn't just caring a whole awful lot from your point of view. True compassion is learning how to care a whole awful lot from other points of view. So keep that in mind as you move forward this week. Do your best to be the best teammate that you can be. Be the best at being you.